Yeah.
I see the house, I see the land. Oh, very exciting.
That's amazing. I had no small world. Oh my gosh, that's so cute. That's so much more positive. I like that. I love that, George. That's amazing.
They paved paradise and put up a parking lot with a pink hotel, a boutique, and a swinging hot spot. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They paved paradise and put up a parking lot. They took out all the trees and put in a tree museum. And they charged the people $1.50 just to see them. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They paved paradise and put up a parking lot. Hey, farmer, farmer, put away that DDT now. Give me spots on my apples, but leave me the birds and the bees, please. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They paved paradise and put up a parking lot. They paved paradise and put up a parking lot. They paved paradise and put up a parking lot.
Come into our house of hope and love, of peace and justice, of wholeness and healing. Come in where we welcome the certain and the seeking, the long timers and the newcomers, the beloved and the brokenhearted. All of you can find a home here at Throop, where we go love the world from the heart of Pasadena and from the heart of our homes. Good morning and welcome to our friends joining us on the live stream. Well, you have wandered into a church where we believe in not paving over paradise, which is evident in our lush and gorgeous garden outside. And today you have arrived at Throop on an extra special, wonderful Sunday where we are focusing on housing justice. And we have a friend of our congregation, the Reverend Bert Newton, who is here as a guest preacher. Hello, Bert, up on the chancel. Yay! Bert is a community organizer with one of our community partners, which is Making Housing and Community Happen. And Bert has been in that role for almost 5 years. And before that, Bert was an organizer with the Greater Pasadena Affordable Housing Group for 19 years. So we really have an expert in local housing with us today. Bert has also served as associate pastor at Pasadena Mennonite Church for 7 years, and Bert continues to be recognized by that community as a ministry associate representing the church in the wider community. Bert is the author of Subversive Wisdom, Socio-Political Dimensions of John's Gospel, and produces a podcast Bible study called Parody and Subversion in Matthew's Gospel. So Reverend Bert will offer the sermon today. And after the service, if you want to know more about Bert's work with housing justice, Bert will be doing a roundtable conversation in coffee hours. Cynthia McDonald in the back pew is helping to organize that. So if you want to talk to Bert more, just look for Bert and Cynthia after the service. And again, what a blessing, Bert, to have you with us on this beautiful Sunday spring day. If you are new to Throop, we love to stay in touch with you. We ask that you fill out an info card that you can find in the pew back in front of you, and you can hand it in a little later in the worship service. And as we gather in, I just invite you all to take a gentle breath. Inhale. And exhale. And let yourself arrive fully into our sanctuary. And we are reminded that each one of us is a light in the world, and the flame from our chalice symbolizes and reflects that light.
Good morning. Our time together in worship is intimately connected with our daily lives. As a symbol of that connection, we light our chalice with a flame from our candles of hope and witness. This flame reminds us that we are one beloved community, bound together in faithful relationship. Here we find belonging and meaning. May we live out our values of love, compassion, and justice, pledging ourselves to greater service in the world. We light a second candle to honor the people and ancestors whose land we now occupy. The land under and around Throop is the unceded land of the Gabrielino Tongva Band of Mission Indian people. May this knowledge and awareness lead us into dismantling systems of supremacies and oppressions. We light a third candle symbolizing our watershed, the Arroyo Seco. May their waters continue to nourish life in our communities. We take a moment of silence, holding all of these in our heart.
And as we continue to gather in, our opening hymn is We Would Be One. I invite you to rise and sing as body and spirit allow. It's number 318 in the gray hymnal, We Would Be One. Take a moment and turn to your neighbor and welcome them into worship. Thank you. This month in worship, we are considering the value of generosity of spirit. And of course, as Unitarian Universalists, we don't believe in just thinking about, although we like that. And we don't believe in just reading about something, although, hello, we all love our stacks of books, most of us, do we not? But we also believe in finding ways to practice ideas and beliefs. And one way some of us have been practicing this belief of generosity is by gathering in our Throop Learning Garden on Wednesday mornings for an hour. And we've been pondering and meditating on some different generosity quotes as we put our hands in the soil and gently weed, although one of the people in our groups pondered, what is a weed really? Are there truly such a thing? And so it's been a really beautiful practice. You know, in our world right now where we live with all of the winter rains, gardens are looking very generous, I'll say, right now, both in their flowers and in their plant life that maybe we don't want where it's growing at this moment. And so to be in our Throop garden and to be thinking about this value of generosity, not just what we as humans bring into our world as generous acts, but looking at ways the garden out there is practicing generosity. And so in addition to a few weeds, we'll say, I mean, maybe some would think not enough weeds, others might think there are plenty. But to see the abundance of wildflowers that have popped up along the western strip along Los Robles, you can see some of the colors really easily from the sidewalk. But there's other flowers in there that are so tiny that you kind of do have to be near the ground and in the flowers themselves in order to see the really minuscule little blossoms of pink and light purple. And to see the abundance of the red ladybugs, you don't see them necessarily if you're just moving by on the sidewalk, but once you're really like in those green stalks, you notice there are ladybugs on like every other stalk, it seems like. They're just everywhere, and then love to land on your arm as your eye wonder, should I be taking its home away right now? That might not be so generous of me. The nasturtium, of course, are hitting their peak. We see the beautiful roses blooming. We notice in our Throop Learning Garden that some of the fruit trees have pink blossoms that are beginning to set, promising that fruit is coming soon. And these are things I notice in our garden out here. And whether you live in an urban area or if you somehow live on a farm, do any of you live on a farm in an urban area? If you go to Descanso or the Huntington or, oh, wait a second, you actually do live on a bit of a farm and you have a beautiful garden. I saw it not long ago. But we all have an ability and an opportunity at this time, this season, to see what is sending up shoots, how the earth is practicing her own kind of generosity with us. And so in the days to come, these days that are bringing sunshine after the rains that came, I think it was yesterday, I invite you to pay a little bit of extra careful, close attention to the rose bushes or to the rosemary or even to long stalks of green, what you might call weeds, and to see what abundant life is beginning to emerge. And every week in this religious home, we remind ourselves of our commitment to love and care for our earth. And we verbalize that by saying together our promise to our planet, and those words are in your order of worship. As members of the family of living beings on earth, we are guided by the Unitarian Universalist principle of respect for the interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part. With hearts filled with love for it, eyes nurtured by its beauty, and minds ruminating on ways to protect its sacred and scarce resources, we promise to nurture the well-being of all life and of the planet itself. And today's responsive reading is inspired by Psalm 2, and it was written by Christine Robinson. And the congregation's response is, we lean into generosity shared by the heart. And let's say that together. We lean into generosity shared by the heart. Why are the nations in an uproar? Why do the peoples mutter and threaten? Why do the rich plot with the powerful? They are rebelling against the demands of love and justice. We lean into generosity shared by the heart. God laughs and cries and says with anger, I have set my love in your hearts and my justice in your mind. You are my children, and I have given you the universe, your lives, and the tasks of your days. We lean into generosity shared by the heart. Be wise. Be warned. Lean into the paths of love and justice. Your restless hearts will find me there. We lean into generosity shared by the heart. In another way, we have been just thinking about the generosity of our religious ancestors here at Throop is by getting inspiration from these beautiful stained glass windows that inspire and offer the most gorgeous light and tell their own stories of both our past and stories from the scriptures in them. And today, to learn a little bit more about our windows, we are going to play Throop stained glass trivia. Who's ready to play trivia out there? Yes, they're ready, raising your hands. So in your order of worship, you have a trivia page. And if you did not pick up an order of worship and you're feeling really sad right now because you're not going to be able to play the game, I think we have extra copies of the trivia sheets in the back, and it looks like Clara is available to hand you one. Does anybody need a trivia sheet? Some of you in the pews, there's a pencil or a pen. Maybe some of you keep one in your pocket. So I'm going to read the question. I'll invite you to, on your own, to answer. And then I'm going to go back through and we'll discover which are the quote-unquote, well, they are correct answers. All right, so are you ready to play Throop Trivia? Yes. Question number one. In what year were the South Aisle windows installed? Was it 1923, 1941, 1923, and 41? And when you have an answer, just quietly circle it on your page or mark it. Question number two. Which stained glass artist created our South Aisle windows? Was it Henry Wynn Young? Was it Charles J. Connick, a magician with light? Or a mix by both Young and Connick? Question number three, what is depicted in four of the South Aisle windows? The Beatitudes of Jesus? The Parables of Jesus? Or the seven Unitarian Universalist principles? Thank you, Jean. Question number four. Which of the following animals is not in our South Aisle windows? Number one, a snake. Number two, the green parrots of Pasadena. Number three, birds. Which one is not depicted in the South Aisle windows? And then number five, blue was chosen over red for the birds in the fourth window because the studio ran out of red glass, because bluebirds were the favorite bird of the window sponsoree, or because of a superstition that said red birds brought bad luck. Okay, we're gonna go up to question one. In what year were the South Aisle windows installed? Who thinks you know the answer out there? Steven. Steven says A, 1923. Does anybody have an alternate answer? Cynthia. Yes, C, 1923 and 1941. I know, Steven, you were so close. So if you notice, they look similar until you get to the one that is on the east end of the aisle, and it's like slightly different colors. It's a little bit of a different theme in it. And so, yeah, they were done at different times. Okay, which stained glass artist created these windows? Was it Henry Wynn Young, Charles Connick, or a mix by both Young and Connick? Who wants to answer? I think I see you right there with the garden. A, Henry Wynn Young, close. Anybody have a different answer? Steve. What did you say? It's the one with the two answers, yes. It's a mix by both Young and Connick. Young did the window that doesn't look like the rest of them, and Charles Connick did the other four windows in this. Okay, what's depicted in these windows? Who wants to share your answer? I'm seeing Matthew. The Beatitudes, yes. And did you know that because you knew it, because you looked, or because you looked ahead in the order of worship? Matthew says he looked over and he could see them. Okay, good. Which of the animals is not depicted in these South Aisle windows? Who wants to hazard a guess? If you haven't guessed yet, I see some repeating hands. Isla. B, the parrots of Pasadena. Were the parrots even here back in 1923 and 41? Tom says no, they weren't even in town yet. And the last one, blue was chosen over red for the birds in the fourth window because who hasn't guessed yet and wants to? I see the Ryans. They said C, a superstition that said red birds brought bad luck. No. Okay, Paula. B, bluebirds were the favorite bird of the window sponsory. And I somewhere saw a receipt for that window that has the change order in it. And it's a really sweet little story that the woman who sponsored the window for her friend told about how much her friend loved bluebirds. And so the stained glass company lovingly switched out the color, and that's why we have bluebirds today. Well, our windows are such a beautiful example of the generosity of our religious ancestors here. When they dreamed of this church, they built of erecting a beautiful church building that would inspire and hold many, many generations of Universalists, and of course later Unitarian Universalists. And now we are the proud stewards of this building, and we find our own ways to practice generosity with each other and lovingly take care of this gift of our religious home. And today in the children's program, they're going to be learning and talking about the concept of home and people who have traditional homes and people who don't have what we think of as traditional homes, and how people regardless practice generosity and love and care for one another. After the service, we'll also be doing our fourth Sunday sack lunch preparations for the Friends in Deed Street outreach team. Kate and Faye, thank you so much for leading the program today. And we have a practice of singing them into that program, and those words are in the order of worship.
For you shall go out in joy, for you shall go out in joy.
Just in the spirit of generosity, I was reminded as we were singing that Terry had brought in sticker prizes for people who got answers correct in trivia, and the Ryans were going to hand them out. And before worship, they said, how are we going to do that? And I said, oh, you know what? I haven't like totally figured it out. It's probably going to be really awkward. And Rachel said, sometimes spirituality is awkward. And so it was so awkward that I forgot to do it. And so if you feel like you've earned a sticker, the Ryans have one, and you can get one from them after the worship service. Thank you, Ryans, and thank you, Terry. And our pondering moment is the Beatitudes from Mark 5. And maybe take some looks into these windows as I share them and see if you can figure out which window symbolizes which of these Beatitudes. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he began to speak and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my behalf. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets that were there before you. As we think about all of those blessings, we sing together number 134, Our World is One World. And you can remain seated as we sing together. This month, as part of our generosity of spirit, we are also engaging in our annual pledge drive. This year, its theme is growing together, and we've been thinking about ways we are growing together as a church community, ways we are growing together in our own spiritualities, and ways we are growing together in our impact in the larger world. And as part of this, we have been receiving gifts of people's personal experiences of Throop and their lives and how they practice generosity here in this community. Today, we're so pleased to hear from Michael Kelly, a longtime Throop member and a current member of our Board of Trustees. Thank you, Michael.
Thank you. Thank you for giving me a few moments this morning to express my generosity for and my gratitude for the things that this congregation has given to me. I'm Michael Kelly, and I've been growing together with you here at Throop for a while. I was a participant with the group that tore up the lawn and planted the garden here about 12 years ago. In those days, quite a few of us spent most Sundays working outside in a sort of religion of the soil, while services went on inside in the sanctuary. Basically, if you saw muddy footprints around the sanctuary, then you knew that some of us had come inside, and that was probably for the music at that point. These days...
And that feels like an awkward spirituality moment.
I know. We, in fact, some of us gardeners were kind of slowly brought in here and then, you know, became more integrated into the congregation, you might say. These days, I still like working in the garden here, and I like doing the occasional repair around the campus, and I currently serve as an at-large member on your Board of Trustees. Reverend Tara mentioned this morning how we had wandered in this morning. I truly wandered in. I never resided in Pasadena, so I might never have found this church. I was volunteering with a nonprofit that rented some space in Henry House next door, so I kind of knew about the place. When I saw a community notice that the music director here was going to give a class in what's called Sabre Gama, which is Indian singing, I decided to show up. And then I stuck around, came downstairs for the service. Before you knew it, I was receiving a big hug from Jean Prince. Here's Jean. Hi, Jean. Who was the board president at that time. And she was also the angel of the garden. Jean was spending hours outside here every week, hand-watering 5,000 square feet of lawn, because over the course of 100 years, the galvanized pipes had rotted in the ground. Well, within a few weeks, I was attending services here in the sanctuary, sitting in on board meetings, and learning the difficulties of lawn care from Jean. I stayed here at Throop in order to be a member of an intentional community. And for me, that community needed to be a community of searchers. And I found that many Unitarian Universalists believed in the mystery of existence and non-existence, and in searching together for paths through that mystery. And that for at least some of us, it was the mystery and not the answer that is sacred. So I didn't come here to find any answers. I came here to join others in a search for meaning. And here I am, and here I hope that I shall be. And I just want to say that receiving the generosity of this place and this congregation means having a place. It means having this wonderful building, this campus. It means having a staff, Fillory and Kate and Reverend Tara and Malcolm, who are here helping us identify questions and then search for the answers to those questions, helping us organize the place, keep programs going, helping us figure out what time things are going to be happening. I have a real problem sometimes with that. So that means expenses. So I want to take a minute, just a minute, to conclude by talking about pledging. And I'm going to ask your forgiveness because I have a very important prop and I wanted to do show and tell. And I left it in the pew. So I'm going to run down and get it.
Oh, another awkward spirituality moment by Michael. Thank you.
This is a pledge form, and what pledging is, in essence, we all come into the church with some generosity in our hearts and with a willingness and an intention to give to the church so that it can continue operating. That intention and that generosity are in our hearts. But it's nice if the church can do planning by knowing what is in our hearts at the beginning of each church year, so that the church and its staff will know how to plan for expenses and so forth. So that's where this comes in. And having said that, I have a confession to make. Do we do testifying in this church? Because I want to testify for a
moment. You're doing it right now.
Okay, I'm going to testify. And the confession that I have to make is that every year I pledge in my heart to make a monthly donation to this congregation. And I like to do it through an automatic monthly deduction so that there's one less thing for me to remember. But here's the thing. I almost never fill out this card. It's been about 6 years since I filled out a pledge card. in the church. And that automatic deduction just keeps going and everything. But, you know, I'm the worst offender in this place when it comes to actually pledging, because I never get around to do it. So last night, I went online and I filled out my pledge for this year. So I'm just so thankful that you've been patient with me in getting around to doing that. And also, thank you so much for letting me say a few comments this morning.
Michael, thank you. And I love the way you framed it as the generosity in our hearts. And I too made my pledge online this year. It's so easy to do. The link is probably somewhere in the order of worship. We also have pledge cards out at the coffee and conversation area. They're by our Growing Together pledge tree. And this year, we have a goal of receiving 45 pledges, and we would love for you to be one of those 45 pledges that we hope to get. And it's very sweet to see your name, if you choose, on a leaf on our Growing Together tree. We do support our congregation in so many different ways. And again, Michael, thank you for sharing the ways you've supported Troop. Once a month, we want to further our values in the wider world by sharing the entirety of the fourth Sunday offering with a community organization that's doing work far beyond what we could do alone here at Troop. And this Sunday, we are really proud to share today's offering with Making Housing and Community Happen. And I've invited Bert to share a few words about the mission and work of Making Housing and Community Happen.
Yeah, thank you, Pastor Tara. And thank you all for allowing me to come. It's quite an honor to be here. And thank you so much for taking up an offering for us. So Making Housing and Community Happen is a Pasadena-based, faith-rooted nonprofit open to people of all faiths, and we work for housing justice. A lot of our work is centered here in Pasadena, but we do coalition and consulting work across the state and educational work across the nation. So we have four teams. Our safe parking team created the first safe parking program for people living in their vehicles in the San Gabriel Valley. We created it here in Pasadena at Trinity Lutheran Church. Our congregational land team consults with congregations across Southern California who want to use their land for affordable housing. It's a long process, but we've gotten at least three congregations to the end of that process where they're ready to break ground on affordable housing. And we are mentoring teams in other parts of the country who are doing the same thing. Our OSHA team is our central organizing and advocacy team here in Pasadena. And we have won a slew of victories, but one of them that you can look at right now is at the corner of Orange Grove and Fair Oaks. If you go to the corner of Orange Grove and Fair Oaks, you'll notice a brand new, beautiful building, and it is going to be 69 units. It's going to open up pretty soon, the next couple of months, 69 units of permanent supportive housing for seniors who are experiencing homelessness. And seniors are the fastest growing part of our homeless population. So that's a corner of Orange Grove and Fair Oaks. Just go and look at it, and that's the result of our OSHA team, which has also won a number of other victories I just don't have the time to talk about. Our fourth team is our North Fair Oaks team, and they're working further up on North Fair Oaks above Washington to transform that part of our city. They want to transform it with complete streets, public art, and affordable housing. And then in addition to that, we do one-day housing justice institutes. We do those in other cities to establish housing justice teams in those cities. So that's a way of replicating ourselves. So we've done that as nearby as Arcadia and as far away as Durham, North Carolina. And we've left housing justice teams in those cities. So that's what we do. We're a small nonprofit with just a few part-time staff, so your financial contribution will go a long way in helping us do our work. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Bert. You can give online. The ways to do that are in the order of worship. And if you give online, you can also choose the checkbox, Fourth Sunday Offering. If you give here in the room, checks and cash are welcomed. And again, unless you note that today's gift is for your pledge, your gift will go to making housing and community happen and all these great projects that they're doing in Pasadena and beyond. Thank you so much for all the ways you practice generosity of spirit. The morning offering will now be gratefully received.
We'll build a land where we bind up the broken. We'll build a land where the captives go free, where the oil of gladness dissolves all mourning. Oh, we'll build a promised land that can be. Come build a land where no one is othered, anointed in love. We will make peace where justice shall roll down like waters, and peace like an ever-flowing stream. We'll build a land where we bring up good tidings to all the afflicted and all those who mourn, and we'll give them garlands instead of ashes. We'll build a land where peace is born. Come build a land where no one is othered, anointed by love. We will make peace where justice shall roll down like waters, and peace like an ever-flowing stream. Come build a land where mantles of praises resound from spirits once faint and once weak, where the oaks of righteousness stand her people. Come build a land my people will see. Come build a land where no one is othered, anointed by peace, where justice shall roll down like waters, and peace like an ever-flowing stream.
In a spirit of gratitude, we lift up those supporting today's worship service. Taryn for running the live stream, Clara and Christy for serving as greeters and ushers, Terry for bringing us our chalice lighting words, Kate and Faith with our children's program, Michael for giving us a generosity moment, Tom for preparing coffee and conversation. I'd like to thank Reverend Bert again for being with us today. Malcolm and choir for always inspiring music, and Fillory for all of your administrative support. And as we give thanks for all the ways we are active in each other's lives and in the larger community, we say together the response to the offering, and that's in your order of worship. For the ministries of the church in our community, we bless our offering with love and hope. And in that spirit of gratitude, and invite you to, again, just take a breath in and exhale. And we turn our hearts and minds to a time of meditation and stillness as we sing together number 86, Blessed Spirit of My Life. To gently take a breath in together, to exhale, and to take a breath in together, and to exhale, and being mindful of your breath and your heartbeat and your body. To hold an appreciation for those who came before us, who had love as a legacy, who created this space of beauty and belonging. And in lives and in a world that all too often feels chaotic and so full of strife and pain and anger, we take a few moments of stillness together, turning our intention to how peace will find a home within each one of us. And imagine how we can share that feeling of peace with those around us and in the wider world. May we find ways for love to be our own living legacy, and for all that is our life, we give our thanks and praise. Amen.
To tell me I was building a dream, and so I followed the mob. When there was earth to plow or guns to bear, I was always there right on the job. They used to to tell me I was building a dream with peace and glory ahead. Why should I be standing in line just waiting for bread? Once I built a railroad, made it run, made it race against time. Once I built a railroad, now it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime? Once I built a tower to the sun, brick and rivet and lime. Once I built a tower, now it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime? Once in khaki suits, gee, we looked swell, full of that Yankee doodly dum. Half a million boots went slugging through hell, and I was a kid with a drum. Say you don't remember, they called me Al. It was Al all the time. Say you don't remember me, I'm your pal. Buddy, can you spare a dime? Once I built a railroad, made it run, made it race against time. Once I built a railroad, now it's done. Buddy, can you spare a dime? Buddy, can you spare a dime? Buddy, can you spare a dime?
Amen. So today we are looking at the Beatitudes. Now, the Beatitudes are a text that I have studied more than any other text, not just in the Bible, but anywhere. I have studied it in its Greek form, and I've studied its structure, what it's referring to. But I'm telling you, I could never guess just by looking at those windows that's what it was illustrating. So whoever guessed that, you're a genius. I would never have guessed that. So anyway, Beatitudes, if you're wondering where the English word beatitude comes from, it comes from the Latin word for blessed. So each of the Beatitudes starts with blessed, and the Latin word from that's where we get the English word beatitude from. So, but many people may not know that there are actually two sets of Beatitudes. Most of the time when we're talking about the Beatitudes, we're talking about the version in the Gospel of Matthew. If you were confused, the bulletin said Mark. It's actually Matthew 5, so it was a misprint in the bulletin. But we're usually talking about Matthew's Beatitudes, but most people don't realize there's two sets of Beatitudes. There's another set in the Gospel of Luke, but we hardly ever hear about that one. That one gets neglected, and I think there's a reason for it, and I don't think it's just that Matthew comes first. I think it's because Matthew's is not only a little bit more, sounds more poetic, but it's also, I think, less threatening. It's a little bit more safe. Because Luke's Beatitudes, if you've ever read them, Luke says, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who hunger now, for you will be filled." And maybe not for this group here today, but for a lot of people, that may feel a little bit more threatening because it actually names and names economic justice and injustice in society, and then promises liberation for those who suffer from economic injustice. Whereas Matthew's Beatitudes, it's a little harder to say what they're talking about. It's, you know, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are the meek, and those aren't. Phrases or words that we use every day, and it sounds poetic, and it could be powerful, it could be something else, you know, so it sounds a little safer. But I'm going to argue that actually Matthew and Luke actually agree with each other. Sometimes you'll hear some commentators will say Matthew balances out Luke, but I want to argue that they actually agree with each other. Now, before I do that, I want to frame it by talking about Jesus himself as how I understand Jesus. And so the first thing is that Jesus, both biblically and historically, is a peasant. Biblically, in the story that we read in the New Testament, Jesus is presented as a peasant. And historically, scholars agree that he's a peasant. This is a consensus that has been achieved over the last 30, 40 years in biblical scholarship, that Jesus, both biblically and historically, is a peasant. There's not much in biblical scholarship that people agree on, but this is one thing that almost all scholars agree on, is that Jesus was a peasant. And the reason that's important is because this is a class analysis, and it tells you something about why he says the things he says and who he's speaking to. So in the ancient first century Mediterranean world, there was almost no middle class. There might have been a small merchant class, trading class that could be identified as middle class, but mostly it was just the upper classes, which were 2 to 3% of the population, the ruling and retainer classes, and then the large peasant class, and maybe under them was the outcasts of society. But the peasants in the first century Mediterranean world were mostly desperately poor. One scholar that recently crunched the data on this, Carol Wilson, she estimated that about 55% of the peasantry in the first century Mediterranean world was at or below subsistence level. And to be below subsistence level meant that you were malnourished or maybe even starving. Starvation was actually quite common in the first century Mediterranean world. So it's important to understand the situation in which Jesus is located. He is a peasant, and he is primarily speaking to other peasants, especially in the Beatitudes. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that Jesus was Jewish, both historically and as presented in the gospel. And this may not be come as a shock to most people today, but there's a long history in the West, especially in Western Christianity, of stripping Jesus of his Jewishness. And the reason it's important when we read the text is because if you're not Jewish, especially if you're not an ancient first century Jew, you may miss a lot of the references being made. As you read through the gospel, there's some overt references to the Hebrew scriptures, the Hebrew Bible, what we sometimes call the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible. But there are overt references, but there are a lot of subtle references, which we'll get into today as we go through the Beatitudes, that a lot of us would miss because we're not steeped in the Hebrew Bible, and so we don't catch these references. So those are two very important framings. Jesus is a peasant, and Jesus was Jewish, and this is both historically and biblically. The biblical presentation is of a Jewish peasant. So let's start with, and I'm going to emphasize the first four Beatitudes, and then go quickly through the second four. I count them as eight Beatitudes with a ninth that's really an extension of the eighth Beatitude. But I'm going to focus on the first four, and they are in parallel with each other. So blessed are the poor in spirit. And so what is poor in spirit? That's not a term we normally hear a lot. It often gets interpreted as humble, right? So poor in spirit kind of sounds like maybe humble. And there are a lot of interpreters who I think are kind of lazy, and they just say, well, that's blessed are the humble. But if you trace this idiom through the ancient literature, it seems to refer to people who are economically poor and politically oppressed. This very same idiom occurs in one of the Dead Sea Scrolls, and it refers to people who are oppressed by a foreign empire. There is a very similar one in the book of Isaiah, which is crushed in spirit. So that's kind of the idea, that blessed are those who are crushed in spirit. And then Jesus says, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So whether you're looking at, Luke uses the term kingdom of God. They're kind of interchangeable, kingdom of heaven, kingdom of God. And there's a tradition in a more modern Christianity of understanding that as a purely spiritual idea. But the original audience would have heard this as not just spiritual, certainly it would have spiritual dimensions, but as a political thing that it was being talked about. And as you go through the gospel story and you unpack what Jesus is talking about, he's talking about a new society of justice and mercy, and I would say also equality. And this is, so Jesus is saying the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven belongs to the poor. The new society belongs to them. That is what he is saying in that first beatitude. Then the second beatitude says, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. So if you're reading this as a 21st century North American and you're in basically a privileged person, if you're not in one of our prisons or you're not on the street or you're not, that's part of another marginalized group, this could be anything, right? We have all kinds of first world problems, right? So we might mourn about anything. But there's a specific reference here for the original audience. They would have realized that Jesus is riffing off of Isaiah 61, which talks about comforting those who mourn. And that passage is about liberation from a foreign empire. And those who mourn is in parallel with the poor and the oppressed. And that's what it's talking about. Those who mourn are those who have been oppressed. Their comfort is their liberation. That passage is also about the Jubilee year, which is a time of radical wealth redistribution, which we'll see also in the next beatitude. So the next beatitude is, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Well, if you translate it that way, that could be powerful, right? The meek will inherit the earth. That sounds pretty powerful, but we don't talk that way, do we? We don't go talking around talking about the meek, right? So we don't really, to inherit the earth is kind of grandiose, so it becomes kind of a sentimental thing the way it's translated. But you can translate that that verse is, blessed are the poor, for they will inherit the land. That's a valid translation. And if you translate it that way, and you are part of the original audience, the original ancient Israelite audience, you realize that that's riffing off of Psalm 37:11, which says the poor will inherit the land. And so again, this is a reference to the Jubilee year, a reference to the year of radical wealth redistribution. In the Jubilee year, all debts were to be forgiven, all debt slaves were to be set free, and all land was to return to its original owners. It was a time of radical wealth redistribution, centering a lot of it on land. So here he says, blessed are the poor, for they will inherit the land. And then in the fourth beatitude, Jesus says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Righteousness. Okay, that's another word we don't usually use outside of a religious context, right? There's this tradition in the English translations to translate this word, that the Greek word is dikaiosune, to translate it as righteousness. But righteousness is a very individual thing. The connotation, right, is of individual morality. But the Greek word connotes more of a social righteousness or justice. And in fact, if you read a Spanish Bible, it'll translate it as justicia, justice. So Jesus is saying, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for justice. Well, who are those who hunger and thirst for justice? They're those who have been denied justice. Again, the poor and the oppressed. So see, the first four are in parallel. They are about the poor and the oppressed and promising them liberation in the new transformed society. Then Jesus goes on to do the next four Beatitudes, and he says, blessed are the merciful, the pure in heart, the peacemakers, those who are persecuted for the sake of justice. So this is setting forth a nonviolent ethic. An ethic of and a practice of nonviolent resistance to oppression. Now, scholars, in terms of the historical Jesus, scholars are sort of all over the map as to whether Jesus was teaching nonviolence or not. But the biblical Jesus definitely teaches nonviolence. It's pretty clear as you go through the gospel that he is teaching nonviolent resistance to oppression. So, in making housing and community happen in our organization, we are nonviolent. We do advocate non-violence, but that's not really, you know, there's not much of an option for us. We don't know how to fight. We don't own guns. So that one's pretty easy for us. But what we really strive to do is be in line with the first four Beatitudes, because what we everything we do, every one of our strategies is about housing and land justice and how we can transform this society into a society of justice and mercy and equality, where everyone, as the prophet Micah says, everyone has a home to live in peace and with no one to make them afraid. So that is our work, and thank you so much for supporting that. And I think afterwards I'm going to be in the fireside room where we can talk further about the work or anything I've said. And so thank you so much.
Would you please rise with us and turn in your hymnals to number 128 in your gray hymnal?
Place a hand on your heart and reach one out to someone in the room or on the live stream. Our chalice is extinguished. We carry its light with us. Go forth and be alive in the world, sharing your own compassion and strength and courage. I love you all. Go out and love the world. Amen and blessed be.
It's from Candide. Little Bill.